know you's in front.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio. Radio.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio. Radio.
Big Manny and Bug.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
Big Manny and Bug.
You should already know when I walk in the door that it ain't no use in fronting on me. You should already know when I walk in the door that it ain't no use in
fronting. Big Manny and Bug.
You should already know when I walk in the door that it ain't no use in fronting on me. You should already know
when I walk in the door
that it ain't no use in fronting.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio. Radio.
Big Manny and Bug.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
Welcome to Jerusalem High, boy.
You're now rocking with that Big Boost Radio.
You ready, Oos?
Big Manny and Bug.
Sir. When I walk in the door, that it ain't no use in fronting on me. You should already know when I walk in the door, that it ain't no use
Big
in fronting.
Big Manny Boogie.
You are not rocking with Big Oos Radio. It is your boy Boogie Oogie Oogie, aka the champ, aka Lakers win. The Lakers are the world champ. They be, just in case y'all didn't know, and y'all might have forgot because it was a couple of days. Let me remind you, boy. We are here. Alongside me, I got my Uso.
Oh, you. Can I get an introduction?
Yes, my Uso.
Can I get an introduction?
My ace, my dog. Introduce yourself, my Uso.
Yes, sir. Big Oos Manny Fresh to death. Nothing less but the best from the West. And I say with my chest. Let's go.
Oh, can you say this with your chest?
Hey.
Can you have one of these? You have one of these that you can see?
I'm gonna get a Super Bowl one this year.
Hey, let's get it. Welcome everybody to another segment of Jerusalem High. Thank you guys for tapping in. We appreciate you guys. Sorry, we want to apologize for the late start.
Yeah.
Once again, the enemy tried to come and sabotage our evening, but as always, God prevails, and we want to thank.
Yes, sir. Or it might have been your flag. I don't know.
No, it was not my flag. It absolutely was not my flag, Manny. But if you're just tuned in, what's up, babe? Shout out to my wife. Be at work tonight. Love you, babe. Shout out to everybody that's on the live tonight, man. We see you guys, man. We are going to have we have a very important speaker on tonight. Before we introduce him, I just want to welcome everybody. Thank you guys for tuning in. If you just tapped in, make sure you guys hit that share button. Did you hit that share button, Manny?
Oh, yep.
Look, oh, you know,
I'm about to hit it again just because you said that.
You know what? I need to do that right now. I'm going to do that right now. I'm gonna say tap in. Lakers are the world champ. Lakers are, hold on, Lakers are the world champ.
It's about something else tonight, Book.
Yeah, it is. But I just want to remind
you. I'm just joking.
Just in case they forgot. What's happening, everybody?
I'm not going to rain on your parade. The Lakers are the champs. We'll get into that.
We'll get into that.
Yeah, you will. You will. You will. You will after.
We will.
If you're looking for Big Oos merch, real quick, if you're looking for Big Oos merch like the one that I got on, Boog probably got one under his Laker jersey, under his other Laker jacket, under his Laker shirt.
Yes.
Tap in at BigOosRadio253.com. I get all your merch there. DM us. Inbox us, email us at BigOosRadio@gmail.com. Check us out on all social media platforms. And we got a YouTube channel. If you miss out on any episode, we would rather have you be part of the live, though, so we can converse with you. You know what I mean?
Yes.
But we have a YouTube channel. You can subscribe. If you want to go back and watch favorite episodes, you can go ahead and do that. So I just had to get all of that out of the way. This guy.
Did you say something? Oh, sorry, Manny. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. I was paying attention to this beautiful trophy, man. But yeah, like Mauso said, man, tap in to get that merch. And once again, we are world champs, baby. Yeah. The Lakers are world champs. 17. This is for the Mamba.
Yes, sir. Respect.
For the Mamba. Cop in, get that merch, tap in. Everybody tapped in. Make sure you hit that share button, man, because we have...
Share.
We have a very important segment. Also, we made a post earlier about an item that actually there's a really cool story behind. You want to share that story? Yeah. How we got connected with this? One of our posts from the Native.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I want to give a shout out to Brother Lee, man. So earlier this week or last week, me and Vince been covering a lot of what's going on back home in American Samoa with the suicide prevention, all the suicide that's going on. And so there's a lot of effort in putting, people are putting into helping suicide prevention, mental health, inner wellness, and all of that stuff. Anyways, I'm on this live, right, with one of my Usos, and there's a few of us on that live, and I'm just watching him pour his heart out towards Samoa and his love. And so I told him, I said, hey, me and Vince, you know, Big Usurity, we're doing a donation thing to send to Samoa. And not knowing anybody on the live, right, I then jump off after. And then I get a message, and the Uso, you know, the Brother Lee hit me up, and he said, hey, I'm Native. The crazy thing is, I'm not even Polynesian. And I wanted to donate. I'm a silversmith for the Navajo Nation, right, for Native tribe. And he was sharing his heart about how he dealt with suicide, how he dealt with demons along the same topic, and how it's affected his people, right? And so he goes on to share his story, and it's really dope. And I, you know, we'll probably have him on here soon so he can share that part of his story. But he said, I want to donate a piece that I made. It's a bracelet, and whatever money that you guys get from this, all the proceeds can go to what you guys are doing. And I thought that was really, really inspiring and really, really dope for him to do that. You know, somebody who's not even Polynesian. The crazy thing, right? So when he came out of the reservation, when he came out of the tribe to get into American culture, the first people in New Mexico that he met were Samoans and Tongans and Fijians. And so he's always telling me, oh, those are my Toko Usos, Craig and them. And, you know, just showing so much love. And so when he heard this about American Samoa, his heart went out to him. So I drove it out there. I drove out there, picked up the bracelet from him. And it's a really, really beautiful piece. Yeah. And so he's made it himself. And it's dope. So you guys, we'll show the video later. Shout out to my brother, Jacob Lee, who's on the line. He's the silversmith. If you guys want to go and say what's up to him on the live. But thank you so much, Jacob. We appreciate you. And so we're going to be doing a raffle later on. Vince, you want to share about the raffle?
Yeah, absolutely, man. I see our Uso man, Jacob Lee, who's on the live. Thank you so much, Uso. We appreciate you. God bless you. And so we're going to raffle, and all the donations that we receive from the raffle will go towards our outreach efforts back home in American Samoa. As you all know, Manny and I were able to gather a whole bunch of stuff this last week that we're sending home. And you actually have time because we actually, and thank you to like everybody back home in American Samoa and folks that are stateside that are helping us ship these pallets back home to Samoa. The pallets actually will leave SeaTac Friday afternoon or morning.
So people still got time, or?
You still have time. You can just hit us up if you want to get something. I know folks have still been slowly bringing stuff, but shout out to everybody that's come through and who's donated whatever it is, man. So many people that I don't want to forget anybody's name, but we know who you are, but more importantly, God knows who you are.
Yep.
And so this item that is donated by our Navajo brother, Jacob, we're going to raffle off tonight. And so we're going to start the bidding at $25. And here's a picture of it. You got that picture?
Oh. Yeah.
I'm going to show you a quick picture. And then Manny's going to pin. How this is going to work is that we'll start the bidding off at $25. And then throughout our segment tonight, you can just text your bid in and say that you'd like to bid, and we'll keep you updated on where we're at. But we're going to start the bidding at $25. Okay. And that'll run throughout our until the end of Jerusalem High this evening. At the end of the show, we'll tell you the bracelet will go to the highest bidder. And those funds and those dollars will go towards our outreach efforts back home in American Samoa. And shout out to Pastor Francis Vival, Heart of Worship Ministries, and some folks that we have on the ground back home who are going to be using a lot of the items that we're sending over as incentive to do outreach throughout the island. So thank you, guys. We love you, Brother Jacob Lee. So, looks like we've already got a bid already. $25. Yeah. There it is. And this is... Thank you. Yes, sir. So the bidding starts at $25. Manny's going to pin the number that you're going to text. And we've already got one bid. Larry Allison. Shout out to Larry Allison, who's already made a bid for $25. So, folks, you're not going to bid on the live. You're going to text. You're going to text the number that we send. Okay. Oh, raffles off. We've got another one. $30. So go ahead and pin that.
Yeah, I'm going to pin it right now.
We are live right now. Thank you, guys. We appreciate you guys. $30 is where we're at. $31.
Vince, can you talk to him real quick so I can.
Absolutely. Where the bidding is at $31 so far. Repa Jennings. I'm sorry. Yeah, Repa's bid $32. King of $35. Look at that love, man. $35 goes to King. She was the first one to bid $35. $36 by Chui Ono. I don't want to mess up the name, so I'm just going to say T. $40 Kinga. Okay, $40 Kinga. $40 Kinga is the first one to bid 40. It is at 40 right now, ladies and gentlemen. Edward, shout out to Mauso Edward from Manapur Bakery. Samo Taco, $45. Edward was the first one to bid $45. Kinga, $50. Kinga has bidded $50. So we're at $50. If you want to top that right now, it belongs to Kinga. It belongs to Kinga for $50. Repa, sorry, Repa, we've already got $55. Naomi is now bidded $55. Naomi is the first bidder. June, $55. With 60, Repa. Repa right now owns it. $50. Okay, there it goes right there. So you guys can go ahead and bid. The last bid was by Repa for $60, and I'm going to honor that, okay?
Yeah.
I'm going to honor Sister Repa's $60 bid. And then you're going to text Manny at the number pinned there. And Manny's going to be filtering through those. But right, the last bid was at $60.
I saw Kingo for $465.
Oh, suddenly.
No, she corrected it. Lucky old Kingo.
Hey, Kingo, $465? That's what I'm talking about. Boy. Okay. Oh, June 75. So, guys. Okay, King is at $100. I'm going to stop the bidding right now.
Yeah.
We're going to stop the bidding on our live right now, please. King was the last one to post $100. So we're going to honor that. We're going to stay at $100. And now we're not going to recognize any more bids that come on the live. You have to text a number that's pinned.
Yeah, and so just like what my sister Judy is saying on the live, the thing is a little delay, right? From our time that we're seeing, and so we don't want to miss anybody. So we figure you text the number so that we can catch, because the text
will be fresh
in real time. So please text the number. We're not going to shout out any more bids anymore. Text the number, and that person will handle all the bidding. Yes. And at the end, we'll announce that. Because we don't want the feed to fill up with the bids, and we forget about. Because we do have a very, very serious conversation
to have with Stephen, ladies and gentlemen. So continue to bidding. Thank you to everybody that was bidding. $100 is the last one I saw. And so currently it belongs to Kingo with a bid of $100. Send your bids in to Manny, and Manny will track those. Thank you, guys. Before we bring on our speaker, I want to share, in light of what's going on, and just to serve as a form of encouragement. A couple of years ago, not too long ago, American Samoa was going through, and Samoa is actually going through a big pandemic as well with the measles outbreak. And so our brothers, our Maori brothers and sisters from New Zealand, during one of their events, dedicated this beautiful song as a way to encourage our people. And so before we bring on our pastor, I want to play this video to kind of set the tone. As we transition and pivot into bringing on our next guest, if we can. That was so beautiful. Shout out to our Maori brothers and sisters from the land of the long white cloud, Aotearoa. Thank you guys. That was such a powerful piece. You see the emotion on them. And even as I watch that piece, man, I can't help but to get emotional. And so we thought that, you know, in light of our conversation tonight, as a way to transition into bringing on a very, very powerful speaker, a mighty man of God, to share and have some dialogue tonight about some issues that Manny and I have taken the time the last couple of weeks to talk about. We felt that it was important to hear a word of encouragement from somebody of the faith. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we are fortunate tonight to have, he currently pastors Good Samaritan Worship Center out of San Diego, California. Ladies and gentlemen, light up our live feed. Put your hands together for Pastor John Liu Lamonga, ladies and gentlemen.
Let's go. Hey, Pastor.
Hello, Vince, brother, Manny. God bless you guys, man.
God bless you so much, Pastor. How you doing?
Doing great, doing really good, man. I'm pretty excited about sharing on this platform tonight. And thank you to the family that is all listening in tonight as well.
Thank you so much, Pastor. I want to first thank you so much for taking the time. We know that it is late tonight, but you've taken the time to spend with us this evening to share in the Word of God. And we are super fortunate to have you on our show this evening. So thank you so much for being on. Tell us a little bit about yourself, Pastor. Where did you grow up? Where's your family from? That kind of thing.
Okay, so I was born and raised in Hawaii, Honolulu, Hawaii. And my mom is from American Samoa, Tapu'timu. And my dad is from Ofu, Manua. And so I'm the oldest of five. And I have three beautiful girls and two granddaughters. And I'm just excited about life and the call of God upon our lives and doing what we got to do every day to help people out.
So you grew up in Hawaii. Did you graduate high school from Hawaii?
Yeah, I went to Kailani Elementary, across from the town of Shira Market in Kalihi. I grew up in Merites pretty much all my life. I had little portions of time in Kuyo Park Terrace, and then a little portion of my life in Camp 4 housing. But majority of my upbringing was all in Merites, MWH. Mm.
Wow. Okay. Shout out to MWH.
So
Pastor.
Pastor lived in all the rivalhoods.
Yeah, there you go, man.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah. When did you find your calling in ministry?
Well, at the age of 19, it's when I had a praying mom and a family and a church family. And it was just awesome because I was in a lot of trouble as a young man, but it's through their powers of prayer that God got a hold of my heart. And at the age of 19, I gave my heart to Jesus. And ever since then, it's been on, man, all the way up. Now I'm going to be turning 57 in a few days here. So just joyful, man. It's joyful to be serving the Lord and to also to serve in the call.
Yeah, awesome. Man. So I hear we have one thing in common, Pastor, that we're both Lakers fans, right, Pastor?
Yeah, I am a Lakers fan. Yes, I am. Hey. Been a Lakers fan a long time ago.
Already my favorite pastor so far, man. Thank you, Pastor. We want to thank you. Manny and I, we've taken the last 2 weeks to talk about some really pressing, important issues that we as a community, as Pacific Islanders, as Samoans specifically, don't normally talk about. And so I think a lot of reasons, well, there are many reasons, is that there is really no outlet, or we don't know how to approach having these kind of conversations. We don't have the expertise, so on and so forth. I think that there are some generational stuff that exists and why we don't have these conversations. But the last 2 weeks, we've covered two very important topics around mental health and then also suicide prevention. Last week, we had two amazing, brave young people from American Samoa who are spinning this narrative around and raising awareness in American Samoa around, and shout out to the Matangi siblings. I see them on the live all the way from American Fangatongo, American Samoa. But these young people have stepped up to answer the call and to raise awareness around this. Because when we had the segment with them, just to give you some context, Pastor, last week, we run Jerusalem High every Tuesday. And last Tuesday, there were three suicides within 48 hours that had occurred on island. And so we got into different discussions around mental health, around suicide prevention, around, and we dabbled just a little bit about around the responsibility of the church and then families, right? And so we wanted to bring you on, we invited you on, Pastor, to speak from a more faith lens when you hear what's happening. And I'm sure you've heard, you mentioned in our conversation earlier that you have strong ties to Pastor David Katina, who's actually doing a lot of groundwork back home in American Samoa. Now, when you hear those things, mental health, suicide, and how it's happening at an alarming rate back home in American Samoa, give us your wisdom on it in terms of your experience and just by hearing those things, Pastor.
Well, suicide is actually a symptom or result of mental issues that are going on with people in their lives. But, let me just share a story with you. There's a story that I read not too long ago, and it kind of, it's very applicable to this moment right now. I read of a guy who had a cell phone, and he, for a couple of days, for almost a whole day, he was just kind of going on his cell phone, and he noticed later on throughout the day that his cell phone wasn't working properly. And so he was kind of taken back by that. So he kind of looked at his cell phone and he looked around the whole iPhone. He said it was an iPhone. That's what I read. It was an iPhone. So he looked around all the perimeters of that phone. He checked into cracks. He looked at the corner, just like all of us do. He noticed that nothing was wrong with it. In fact, it looked just as brand new as when he first bought it. And then there was a couple of things that started happening to his cell phone. The first thing he realized in his cell phone was that he was not receiving any text messages. So that kind of blew him away. So when he ran into a couple of friends that day, they said, "Hey man, what's up? You blocking me or what? You know, I've been texting you." And he goes, no, man, you know." So he looked and he said, "Man." So his friends showed him. The story went on, said his friends showed him, "Hey, look at the text." And finally realized, "Wow, no man, you know, something must be wrong with my phone." Then the second thing that he realized was that he couldn't text other people. So that was another thing that was happening. The third thing that he realized was that he tried calling people, but he couldn't connect with people. So the story here that I share and present here is same thing with mental illness and people that are going through depression, anxiety, and fears in their life. They don't look like your normal, they don't look like an oddball, in other words. These people look just like you and I. Mm. Every day they're walking the streets, they're doing their thing. So you can't look at them and say, "Wow, that person is suicidal," because that person may look normal, totally on the outside or exterior part, but inside, inwardly, he's jacked up. He's messed up and it looks very ugly. So when it comes to like dealing with people that has mental issues or mental illness, these are people that are walking among us every day and they look just like us. They're not going to tell you exactly what they're doing. They're not going to tell you that they're seeing a psychiatrist, or they're not going to tell you they're on meds because of their mental illness. They're not like, I don't know if you guys, you guys might be a little young, but I remember growing up in junior high and, you know, when you get a cast or some kind of injury on your hand or your arm, you know, people found it to come to school and kind of brag on the cast because they want people to sign their cast. You know, sign, hey, look at me, you know, on my cast, you know. So you see a physical injury on that individual. But people with mental illness, you don't see that. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes it very difficult for many people to really find symptoms when it deals with mental illness and the people that are going through it. Now, there are some obvious signs that we could see to you know, to people that may have mental illness. But I'm speaking about majority of the people. They're sitting on the bus. They're riding with you in your car. These are the everyday people that are probably battling heavily with mental depression, anxiety, and fear, which all leads to suicide. That's one of the biggest things. You know, in fact, let me just put it to you like this. In 2018, in 2019, going into the year 2019, depression was one of the main leading causes to suicide. I mean, we're in 2020. This is 2018, 2019. So I'm going to say that even in 2020, it's still the same leading cause. Depression is still the same leading cause. I don't know how much more you want me to go, but I can continue on to tell you there's some factors here that we need to look at when it comes to dealing with mental illness, or when you're talking about some of the things. And I can also share a little bit of a biblical point of view as well concerning this issue.
Yeah, no, that's all great. Thank you for everybody. If you just tapping in right now, you are listening live to Pastor John Liulamanga, ladies and gentlemen, from Good Samaritan Worship Center in San Diego, dropping some gems on us. And we're having this great conversation around mental health, around the role of maybe the church, pastors, responsibility for people of faith. And then one of the things that's come up in many conversations that Manny and I have been a part of, Pastor, is why is this such a difficult topic to talk about in your typical Psalm 1 home?
Yeah, that's very interesting. And, you know, it's kind of a love-hate kind of a relationship, you know, when it comes to talking about, when you're talking about the Samoan culture, because we have a whole total change of culture today from when our parents grew up, or, you know, our forefathers. They grew up in a whole different generation. They grew up in a whole different time, and the way that they would relate and deal with situations are much more different than what we deal with. Back then, I was just telling somebody the other day that back in, I was told by a brother of mine that that back in the day of, in Samoa, people never had television. They never had cell phones. They never had all these things that we have today. So when you're talking about culture and the past, the older generation to the younger generation, you're talking about a whole two different types of culture. And one of the biggest things that I see is that it's hard because I grew up hardcore. I mean, the way I grew up, I was very hard. I was heavily disciplined. You know, I was raised by my aunt. You know, my aunt that raised me, she was a very strict person. I mean, if I was 5 minutes late from my original time that I was supposed to be home from school, I would get beat up for that. Or, you know, if I went to the store and came back with, instead of a 5 pound sugar and 5 pound flour, I'd get beat up for that. One of the worst times in my life that I experienced, and I'm just kind of relating to like what their mindset is like. One of the most torturing times of my life, and funny because we're in October, local Kamiki. That was one of the most dreaded moments of my life to be taught White Sunday verses, scriptures. I mean, and we're not talking, you know, like one verse. We're talking like the whole book of Genesis, you know. We're talking Genesis to Revelation. So, I mean, that was a very hard time, you know, during that time growing up. But now we're seeing a whole different culture, a whole different generation. And one of the biggest issues that is seen is that I see is that there's not really an appreciation or an identity to understand maybe what the older people had done. And rightfully so, because I mean, I'm sitting among young people and they're always constantly complaining about the older people. But my combat to them is like, thank God, because you're here, it's because of them.
Yeah.
But there are challenges because the parenting is different from them and to us. You know, I got whoop a lot. But with my kids a lot now, I talk to them.
Yeah.
You know, because we're living in a whole different time. You know, now I sit down and say, here, listen, baby, let me share with you some stuff. Back then, there was no sharing. I mean, you just got whacked. I mean, you got hit, you got huspao, you got 2x4, you got the knife, you got the chair thrown at you, the table.
You got the chainsaw.
Yeah, you got the chainsaw.
You got the tank.
You know? No, but, you know, to say all that is to say I really appreciate that, because I wouldn't be where I'm at today because of them. But at the same time, there has been a change and a shift in so many areas of our culture that our older people, and not to say in a bad way, that they have not caught up to, but we have. And so if there's going to be change, we can start making some changes where we're at our level right now in this culture right now.
Let me ask you something, Pastor, because you said this is the way that you were disciplined coming up. And believe it or not, I think Manny, you know, share the same experience. That's the same way I was brought up. I mean, that's the cloth that I was cut by. Mm-hmm. Old school, you know, my dad was in the military, you know, and so he comes from a long line of other strong Samoan men, comes from an old school father. And so I'm guessing that he was parented that way, right? Now, when you say that you were parented that way from kind of this kind of hardcore upbringing that many Samoans are used to, right, why have you decided to change that style of parenting?
Well, a lot of reasons, because one of the reasons, because I understand the times that we're in, and I'm understanding the days that we're living in, and not only that, but being a believer, you know, my whole concept and principle that I live by is, how can I win people over to Jesus? And that applies as well, not just to people outside of my four walls, but that applies inside my home. Because like we've said it and you guys heard it, you guys are both PK kids. You know, we've heard it time after time. The first church is our home. And so we need to be able to affirm minister. So, you know, the methods change, but the message remains the same. So we may change our methodologies, but the message remains the same. And so my change is because, even though I grew up the way I grew up in, you know, my life is pretty much all projects. I grew up in a low-income housing all my life, seeing welfare and you know, wearing second, third-hand clothes from, you know, I mean, you know, it's just totally changed. And when my youngest brother was born and we lived in Mayor Rights, my brother, when he started growing up, he wanted stuff. You know, we got stuff from like Kmart, you know, Walmart. We got stuff from those stores. But when my brother got up, his generation, it was like Nike, Adidas, and that kind of brand. So you understand that things have changed.
Yeah.
And what I realized is that I am not a product of my environment. I'm a product of my choices. That's one of the things that I realized in growing up, is that I am not a product of my environment, but I'm a product of my choices.
That's so good.
You know, so, and that's what all of us need to, even now that we're parenting, because it's not looking at the past and seeing what's happened with our forefathers or our parents. It's now what's happening right now. What can we do to make some changes moving forward? How can we change this whole trend of mental illness and anxiety and fear among our people, and how can we implement faith in them? And now, And so then that's a whole different, you know, ball game in itself, because you just got to deal with the area of dealing with your home first, you know, before you can even start to implement anything else to be added to your everyday life, you know? Yeah. So, you know, so, I mean, you know, so that's this, you know, and so I realized growing up that, man, you know what, I'm a product of my choices, and I got to make some wise choices.
That's good.
If I'm going to move forward, I got to be a good dad, a good father. I made that choice to make to be a good father, a good husband, you know, a good family man, a good pastor.
Yeah.
You know, so everything I do, I try, and I don't try to relate back to, wow, I got beat up all my life. You know, I got, you know, my auntie used to beat me up for it. So I don't blame those things. And I'm just thankful. I'm grateful for those things because they brought me to the table. They brought me to where I'm at right here, speaking to you on this platform.
Yeah, that's so good. We spoke on that a lot, Vince, last week and the other episode, on like not looking towards the past to blame, but looking towards the past to understand and then do something about do the right thing going forward now, right? And so a lot of times I think, like, even in the world that we live in now, I think sometimes we look to the past to like point fingers today, right? We look to the past to like, hey, man, you did me wrong. Or my dad, this is the reason why I'm like this, because my dad did this and this, or my, you know, whatever happened in that person's life. But I think, you know, if we ever look to the past, it'll be to grow the future. So we can grow in the future. And I wanted to ask Pastor something, because you said something that we kept saying last week too as well. And it's so good to hear you say it, is the methods, the goal never changes, but the methods change with the times, right? And so, how crucial, because I always tell my wife this, right? I said, babe, you know me, I'm so thankful that I'm born in 1986. And she goes, why? I said, because I got a little taste of the old school and I'm still relevant in this new school. So I can bridge the gap. And, you know, the work that me and Vince do, we work with youth. And a lot of times in the home, that's the issue. It's connecting this generation to this generation and bringing them together, right? How crucial would you say the generations are, especially those who are like in the 80s and you know, our generation that's in the middle of the old school and then referring to the new school?
The baby boomers.
The baby boomers.
Well, it's very crucial. I think it's very big, because you guys really influence your parents. Now your parents are at a point in life where now they're listening to you, and they're taking some of your advice, and they're watching some of the things you're doing. Although they're constantly always going to implement their ideologies and their way of life and their discipline and their culture, they're always going to implement that. That's going to be always a part of your upbringing. But your generation has a lot to do to connecting an older and a younger generation. Mm. It has a lot of volumes. If you look at the music today, you look at the way culture is today, it's been from this generation that has changed everything. And so, if there's going to be a connection being made, it's going to be your generation that's going to make that connection. There's going to be people like, you know, there's very rare that you'll see people like us, like myself, you know, around. And I'm not saying that, you know, we're extinct, but I'm just saying that there's still people like me out there. And even there's people that are much younger that are going through their changes. You know, let me just give you a prime example. I was watching an AT&T commercial the other day, and it showed a 16-year-old boy playing his game. He was gaming in the living room, and his 12-year-old brother walked behind him and saw him, and said, "Well, what are you playing?" And he goes, he told him what the game he was playing, but then he goes, the 12-year-old looked at his brother, a 16-year-old, and says, "Man, that is old stuff, man." You know, so I mean, they were pointing out the changes that have taken place and how rapidly it's changing. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, some of our older generation cannot adapt to that change, not as fast as what you guys can adapt to, or people like myself that can hopefully understand some of these things.
Yeah.
But you know, but when we're dealing with mental illness, and just kind of talking a little bit about that, there are just a couple of things that I want to highlight with us here today, if you guys don't mind.
Yeah.
But I just want to highlight some of the things that when we're dealing with mental illness, there are three things that I see that that cause a big ripple effect on the lives of people on a daily. And the first thing, and social media plays a big part of it. We know now, I mean, because this is pretty much a social media generation. Mm. I mean, we've all, I mean, I'm with the, well, before, we didn't even have social media in my time. And then MySpace came along. And then all of a sudden, you know, we started going from MySpace and then we started seeing all these other things. But there are three things that I see here, and I just kind of really want to be quick about these things to just share with our audience here today. One of the biggest issues that I think when it comes to mental illness and depression and all the other things that we're seeing in our world today, there are three things. The first thing is I see is that there's a lot of comparison going on. So when you look at social media, because you're unhappy, you look at social media and you compare yourself to the very people that you may look at and says, wow, you know, I am so unhappy. Why are they so happy? You know, yeah. So there's a lot of comparison going on. You know, we try to keep up with the with everybody else around us. In our time, it was like trying to keep up with the Jones and the Smiths. But in social media and many other platforms that we're facing in our society, there's a great there's a great problem with comparison. People are comparing themselves to other people and other things. The second thing, let me just kind of rush through it. The second thing that I see is that why we're seeing a lot of mental illness and a lot of different things, anxiety, fear, is because we're in a fatherless generation. Mm. Now, fatherless generation is crucial because play a big role. You both are dads. I'm a dad. Our responsibility as fathers should not be taken lightly because we affect our home drastically and so much. So let me just tell you a couple of things here that I see that one of the first things that I see that I just wrote it down here. 63% of youth suicide comes from fatherless homes.
Wow.
63% comes from fatherless homes of youth suicide. 90% of youth run away because of fatherless homes. 90% of runaway comes from fatherless homes.
Wow.
The third one that I discover is 70% of men 70% of men in person come from 70% of people come from kids come from fatherless homes. So we, of course, you see the pandemic that we're facing and why there's so much mental illness, why young people are struggling, because there's not a mom and dad at home. And even if there is a dad, he can also be very absent in the home, which cause a ripple effect on your kids and in your home.
That's good.
So, you know, so these are some things that people need to think about is that we're seeing a comparison why people are going through depression and anxiety because there's a lot of comparison going on. Not only that, but they're dealing with a fatherless generation. The third and final thing that I'd like to share here is that what we're seeing, and we all know this because it's something that we hear echoed all the time, is that we live in a selfie or self-centered generation.
Mm.
It's all about me, myself, and I. And you see that. I mean, if you look at your music today, your top 10 music that you listen to, it's all about me, myself, and I. It has always something to do with me, myself, and I. Wow. You look at the politics, it's me, myself, and I. You look at the arts, it's me, myself, and I. If you look at entertainment, it's me, myself, and I. And so when you get people that are growing up in this culture and they're seeing and being exposed to comparison, being involved in the fatherless generation, and then seeing a very self-centered culture, you kind of wonder, no wonder why there's so much mental unstableness, why there's so much mental illness among our youth. So then we can translate that and say, well, why are there so many challenges that we're seeing in American Samoa? Why are so many challenges we're seeing here in the US and abroad? Because there are great challenges that are before us when we look at all the things that are happening in our very homes, in our cities, and in our neighborhood, in our very place where you and I call home. And like I said earlier, they don't look like an oddball. They look just like us. They've been driving in our car. They've been probably walking at the store. There are people that we talk to every day. And yet they're going through a lot of pain, depression, fears, anxieties, and depression, and all these things, which, you know, we don't know what they're, you know, what some of the results may be because of that effect upon their life.
That's really great, Pastor. Yeah. Some great nuggets. And I hope that you guys on the live are taking notes. I know I'm taking notes as Pastor's dropping some gems on us. I wanna talk to you, Pastor, from the lens of the young kid who is in the home right now, who is struggling to find safety. And I want to acknowledge everybody who's on the live right now. Everybody is dropping some wisdom. Everybody's in standing
asking
in
questions,
Pastor, and you guys are asking some great questions. Thank you guys. And so I want, you know, I want to speak from that lens, Pastor. If I'm that young kid at home who's struggling because, you know, of whatever trauma that I've been impacted by, and nobody has given me a way to share that feeling. Because when you think about culture, right? For example, we just watched a video, a powerful video, where you saw these warriors, right? And this powerful dedication they gave to our people. But when you think about Samoan culture, when you think about Polynesian culture, there's this aura of masculinity that's attached to that. And so that narrative is always, right, is always taught to us, or that is the narrative that's always fed to us in terms of how to be a young man, to not cry, to be strong, to find a way to weather through that, right? All great elements. But in a place, if I'm a young man or young lady and I need a little bit more than that, and I don't understand how to do that, right? And I want you to speak, because there are parents on our live. I'm a parent, so I'm listening. And as a way for us to kind of share our thoughts, and I think it's great to hear your wisdom. What is your response? What are your words of encouragement to that parent who's not being open enough to you, or not giving a space for their children to share what's in their heart? Because there's always, right, this level that I have, the standard that I have to live up to in terms of my masculinity, or how to be strong and strength that's tied to who you are as a people. We get that. But if I've gone through some trauma, right, and I can't resonate with that, I need something a little more, and that's not happening, right? What do you say to that parent? What do you say to that young person who's on tonight? And just to wrap it up before you answer, Manny and I shared this thought, is that we're both in ministry, and I know you can relate to this, and anybody who's in ministry can relate. As a youth leader, I'm called to be there to serve our youth, to give all that I have, to put the programs together, whatever it is, teach Sunday school, whatever it is, right? And oftentimes, we give so much of ourselves in those moments, right? That the truth is we neglect our own children. And so when my children come, when my girls come and they need something from me, I'm exhausted because I've given everything, right? To the ministry, right? And so, but I need to be mindful that I need to give, you know, that equal amount of time, love, and care to my own children, the same way that I've given to the ministry. And so, you know, when I ask that question, I'm thinking about young people who might be impacted by that same similar thought process, or the parent who's not taking the time to, like, who thinks like, oh, you'll be okay. Everything will be fine until something happens. And it's like, oh, I didn't see the writings on the wall. You know what I mean? So I'm interested to hear your words of encouragement, Pastor.
Yeah, so Vince, on that aspect, sometimes, you know, it's kind of hard to detect that sometimes, because especially when it comes from a home, and people are bottling it up inside of them, and they're not being able to release the thing. Let me just give you a story here. Let me give you a story from, can I just get a little biblical here just for a moment?
And of course,
share with you. Let me share with you a story here from the Bible. So in 1 Kings chapter 19, okay? And so it talks about, and let me just go ahead and highlight that, and then I'm going to deal with some of these questions that you're talking about. So here in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1, it says this: Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Now, previous to that, in chapter 18, there was a Elijah called out the false prophets, and they had this big thing where they were building two altars. So I'm not going to re-preach it, because everybody, you can read it for yourself in 1 Kings 18 and 19. But he did this altar thing, and so they built an altar, they called out to their God, and it got to the point where Elijah was mocking them. Said, come on, maybe he can't hear you, go a little louder. Maybe he's using the bathroom, he can't hear you. So he's going on, he's taunting them, and then Elijah did something a little bit more out of the extraordinary. He built an altar, but he also made a trench around it and put water on there. So in your mind, you would look at it and say, wow, that's impossible, how a fire can really light up this altar with all this water on there. So anyways, he calls up to God, and God answers and brings the fire on and licks up that water and consumes it. Immediately after that, the Bible says Elijah totally annihilated all them prophets, false prophets. So then he comes to verse 1 in chapter 19. Now King Ahab is now telling Jezebel, his wife, hey, listen, this is what happened. But I want you to pay attention to verse 2. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, may the gods deal with me, be it over so severely, if by this time tomorrow, he's telling Elijah this, I do not make your life like that of one of them. Talking about what he just did, right? So let me just bring a couple of factors to you here, and just to kind of deal with what you're talking about. So one of the first things that I see in this story, with this Bible story, is that there are three truths that we got to understand if we're going to talk about people that are going through this struggle of mental illness, depression, and fear, and anxiety. Now, now, how do you deal with that? And how do you deal with people that are going through it? And that's what we're going to address here, just your question that you're asked. But I'm going to use the biblical reference here to bring that to bring the answer across.
Yeah.
So here's the three truths that I see in this whole thing. Okay, the first truth I see is that when Elijah received the word, and I'll read the rest of it, okay? So he says in verse 2, Jezebel sent a messenger, Elijah, to say, but here's verse 3. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. So one of the first factors of truth that I think we need to understand is that fear causes anxiety. Hmm. Any type of fear that you and I face causes anxiety. I mean, we are living proofs of it every day. The only difference of those that are dealing with mental illness versus what we're dealing with is that we have faith in God, and we believe that God, you can help us, we trust you, and we have all this. And talking about that with the church is another issue here that we want to deal with. But the thing I really want to bring across is fear causes anxiety. It makes us run away from situation at hand. So what tends to happen with people that are going through mental illness is because of the fear and the anxiety that they have in their lives or what they're going through, it causes them to run away instead of to. It makes them go from, gets them away from the situation that they are dealing with in their life. So fear is false evidence appearing real. Mm. Let me just bring that again to you. Fear is false evidence appearing real. So one of the things that we have to understand is that in this story, we find that Elijah, when he heard the news, the Bible said he was afraid and he ran for his life. So people that are dealing with mental illness, going through depression and anxiety, one of the signs that you will see in their lives is they will run. They will run. And so they will actually kind of dismiss themselves from your presence. Here, let me tell you the second thing, because I want to move right along. I don't want to take too much time of everybody here tonight. But 1 Kings chapter 19, in the next three, four verse, it says here, Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. And when he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there. And verse 4, listen to this. While he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. The second thing that happens with people with mental illness is not only that they run, but the second thing is isolation. There's an isolation that takes place. What Elijah did, he's isolating himself from his servant. And the Bible says he took a day journey to get away from everything. Now, people that are going through mental illness, that's exactly some of the signs that you will see. You will see that they're not only going to run, but they're going to also isolate themselves from everybody. You're going to start seeing people being quiet, and people that used to be motivated and active and very involved with the community and church. And these people they were there at Bible studies. Now, slowly but surely, when they start dealing with fear and anxiety, depression, and all these different symptoms that start to come in and creep into their lives, guess what happens? They start to isolate themselves. And that's what happened with Elijah. He isolated himself. Let me give you the third thing, okay? Because I'm going to move right along just for the sake of time. So the third thing is that this is what happened. And this is to answer your question, Vince, to bring it right back home to you. So the third thing to see here in the scripture is found in verse 5, in the last portion of verse 5, and it goes to 7. It says this, an angel touched him and says, get up and eat. Now, there's a supernatural thing that took place here. Thank God for that. Thank God for the Holy Spirit and the supernatural thing. So what I'm saying to you, for people that are listening, that even though you got mental illness, even though you got depression, even though you got anxiety, even though you're facing fears in your life, there's still a supernatural move of God that can still touch your situation. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what you're dealing with. Doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter if you're in the most lonely areas of your life at this very moment. God can still reach down supernaturally and touch you. The Bible says an angel touched Elijah when he, first of all,
ran away.
Second of all, isolated himself. Mm-hmm. The angel touched him. Watch, verse 6. And he looked around, and there by his head was some bread and baked over hot coals and jar of water, and he ate and drank. And then he lay down again. Okay, so I'm going to tell you something here. This is something that I hope that your listeners will get when it deals with mental illness. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord came back, and the Bible says here, a second time. A second time. So the first time he came, the angel supernaturally invaded. Not only that, but he cooked him something. He made him bread, water, told him, wake up, Elijah. Had something to drink and eat. And then Elijah went back to sleep. Then the angel came back a second time. That's key. Why? Why is that key? Because even while you're going through your mental illness, God is not giving up on you. God will never give up on you. He will still come at you. He will still knock on your door. He will still provide the living water. He will still bring the bread of life. He will still come and says, cast your burdens upon me, for I will give you rest. So let me just go a little deeper than this. Okay, so mental illness, sometimes mental illness, you know, it's okay not to be okay, but it's not okay to stay that way. So it's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay that way. And one thing about God is he's not going to allow you to stay that way.
That's good.
He's going to come at you. Yeah. He's going to come. And God is going to come at you no matter what situation you're dealing with. Why? Because people with mental illness, let me tell you, God has a gift and a plan for you. He has a purpose. Your journey with God and your purpose here on earth is not done yet. There's so much more that God wants to do in your life. Now, let me close with this thought, okay, Vincent, Manny, before we go on. If you read on the rest of the passage of the scripture, he says, he tell him, eat the second time because your journey is too much for you. What he's saying to Elijah, he says, hey, you can't do it, but I can, is what he's saying. People that are dealing with mental illness, I want to comfort you and tell you right now, if you have a son or a daughter or if you have somebody in your family, or if you have people that you know in school that are struggling with mental illness, can I tell you, encourage them by telling them that God has a plan and there's the favor of the Lord upon them and that God is not giving up on them. Let the Holy Spirit that works in me and you two boys here is the same Holy Spirit that is working through that person that is going through that mental illness. Now, let me tell you something. Something right here that we all need to understand and be impacted by. It's okay to get some good rest. That's some good advice right there. Yep. He said, hey, you listen to what he, you read the whole story. It blew me away. Because after he got his rest, after he ate good food, after he drank and was nourished well, sometimes mental illness, and I'm not saying it's all mental illness, but sometimes mental illness, you need to take medicine. And that's good. You need to get advice of a psychiatrist. That's fine. You need to get a seek help of a doctor. That's fine. It's not all spiritual is what I'm saying. Sometimes mental illness has to be physical. That's and so good. Guess what happened? God told him, get some rest. That's what you need. You need to get some rest. You need, because when you're operating with a fog mind, when you're operating in anxiety, when you're operating in fear, when you're operating in depression, guess what? Your mind is fogged. Yeah. You're not thinking right. That's you're thinking in a different cloud, in a different hemisphere. You're in a whole different planet, different from everybody else. So you're walking around, even though you look normal and you're good, but still you're dealing with issues inside. But you need to get rest. You need to see a doctor. You need to take medication. So this is the final analysis that I want to close with. And just to let you know, this is what God told Elijah after he did all this to him. He says, get up. Get up. Get up, Elijah.
That's so good.
When he got up, guess what happened? There was, after he got up, things started to change. He took a 40-day journey. 40-day journey when he was just about to kill himself. Wow. In fact, he took a 40-day journey when Jezebel wanted to kill him, and then he turned around and told God, you kill me. Wow. And God says, I still got work for you, but let me just tell you, you need to get some rest. Some of us that are going through mental illness, sometimes, guess what? You need to chill. You need to get back up. After you chill, after you eat good, after you get the right stuff in you, after you've seen your doctor, after you get medication, get back up to fight again, get back up to dream again, get up to serve again, get up to work again, get up to live life again.
That's good.
Because God has a plan and a purpose.
That's so good.
Now, let me tell you, let me close with this last thought. This is good. He wasn't done with Elijah after he had gone through all this depression and anxiety and fear in his life. Shortly after that, Elijah put the mantle of the anointing on Elisha. It only goes to tell you that no matter what you're struggling with in your life, God still has a plan for you in your life to infect and to impact other people around you with your situation. So I just want to encourage your audience up here, man, get up and fight again. Get up and we may not know what's going on in your home, but this is where the church needs to come in big, right here. The church, whether, you know, we the church, people of unconditional love. In other words, it doesn't matter how you look, whether you have a lot of earrings or you have a lot of tattoos or whether you're walking in, you're happy and yet you're depressed inside, you're happy or you're going through a lot of anxiety, no matter how they look or what sect of life they're from or what social status or financial status they're from, the church needs to stand in that gap and embrace everybody because we don't know what they're going through. Everybody that goes to church needs to feel love because that is a connection to the love of God. And so I just want to encourage your audience, man, get up and fight again, get up and dream again, get up and pray again. You got family that are going through mental illness, man, pray for them. And that's a different subject, man, because I can get into this pretty deep.
Yeah.
but I just wanted to share that with you guys, man.
Yeah, that's really good. I sorry, Vince, my bad.
Go.
Oh, just the ending part of that story too. To get up again, to inspire others. I think getting up is very crucial, because a lot of times when we deal with the darkness, right? When we deal with a lot of darkness in our mind, it becomes a comfortable place when we start chilling there for a long time. And so it's always our go-to method. You know what I mean? And so a lot of times, like say I feel like I'm healed again, I feel like I'm moving, and da da da, and then boom, trauma hits me again, and then I'm quick to run back to that place because that's all I know. You know what I mean? And so for Pastor John to encourage us to, hey, don't go back there. You got fed, you got your rest, you got your water, you're nourished. Get up and keep going, keep dreaming, keep living, keep fighting. You know what I mean? And I thought that was so powerful.
Yeah.
Can I just excerpt this one thought here, please
before do.
I close. So Exodus chapter 3, and I want to say this to those that are going through mental illness, and those that are parenting those that are going through this struggle. And I want to tell you, first of all, you're not alone. You're not alone in this battle. You're not alone in this fight. Those in American Samoa, you're not alone. You got a host of people here in the U.S. that are praying for you.
Yeah.
You got a host of people all around the world that are standing in the gap for those young people in American Samoa. So you're not standing alone. But Exodus chapter 3, verse number 7 to 8, and it says this, and the Lord said, and this is what he said to the children of Israel, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and I've heard their cries because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So here's three things that I believe that you need to know and to be comforted by if you're a parent or those that are going through it, is that one of the first things that he says in verse number 7, he says, I see what you're going through. God sees that. There's nothing that does not go unseen in the eyes of God. God said, I see your oppression.
Yeah.
I see your depression. It's comforting to me to know that there's a God that loves me that much, that he sees my situation.
Yes.
The second thing that I see in this verse, he says that of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry. God hears you. So whatever cries, whatever moaning, whatever groanings that you have inside of you, no matter what it is that you're dealing with, when it comes to mental illness or you're dealing with people that are in going through mental illness, I want to let you know that God not only sees it, but God hears it. God hears your cry. He hears your moaning. He hears your agony. He hears your pain.
That's good.
The third and final is because of their taskmaster, or this is what he says, for I know their sorrows. God knows your pain, man. God knows exactly what it is that you're dealing with, whether you're struggling through rejection, whether you just broke up with a girl that you were so in love with, or vice versa, or maybe you didn't have the most upbringing, and yet, you know, you're still counting on looking at your environment, and God is saying to you tonight, I see, I hear, and I know what you're going through. And guess what he says in verse number 8? He says, I'm sending you a deliverer. That's what he says in verse 8. He said, I'm sending you a deliverer. There, he sent Moses. But who is Jesus? Who is God sending for us? Jesus, his son. Not only that, but guess who else he's sending? He's sending you and I in the flesh of the Lord to minister to those, to let them know, I see you, I hear you, I know, and I'm here for you. So God bless you guys. Thank you, man.
Thank you so much, Pastor, for that encouraging message. Everybody who's on the live, thank you guys so much for sharing. Be encouraged by Pastor John's words. If you're in the San Diego area, California, you can see Pastor John at Good Samaritan Worship Center in San Diego, California. Do you have an address that we can share, Pastor?
Yeah, it's 766 28th Street, San Diego, California. They looked that up, 766 28th Street, San Diego. Yeah, welcome. Come in, man. Our doors are always open.
Thank you so much for all your work and for all of the wisdom that was shared tonight. Definitely informal for us who are listening. And our prayer, Manny and I, is that anybody who's tuned in tonight is that you would be encouraged by everything that the pastor shared tonight. I took some notes here, and pastor closed out with this amazing kind of mantra of get up,
yeah,
get up, you know, and fight, and that, and then, and all, I was also reminded in that story that you shared, that and how God never, how he continued to send his angels.
Yeah,
I mean, that is his, that's unconditional love. That is his love for us, his people. And so how amazing, how wonderful is it that we have a God who loves us that much, that there are no conditions to his love. And so I want to thank Pastor John on behalf of Big Oosh Radio, everybody that's on the live tonight. We don't have enough money to pay you. We don't have enough Big Oosh Radio shirts to send you. But our prayer is that God continue to cover you, continue to anoint you, continue to order your steps as you lead your flock, and continue to lead his people back to the Christ and this great commission of making disciples of all men. And so we pray blessings upon you, Pastor, and your family, and our love and our prayers to you. I'm going to turn it over to Manny for some final words.
Thank you so much, Pastor. We appreciate you. Bugs pretty much said everything. I really wanted to ask if you could please pray over our life. We never know who's listening.
We never know,
you know, just like what you shared about the iPhone. You know, we all look, you know, I might be it. You know, Vince might be it. We don't know. And we don't know what we go through, what each other go through. And so I'm going to ask if Pastor can just give us in a word of prayer for those who are going through that, for Samoa and everything that's going on around us. Please, Pastor.
Amen. Father, we just come before you, Lord. And God, we're just people that just love you. And we're just beggars to tell another beggar how to find bread. Lord, I pray that you help those that are struggling at this very moment with depression, anxiety, fears, all kinds of different mental illness issues, Lord. Father, I pray right now to break the curse in Jesus' name. Break the spirit upon their lives in Jesus' name. Set them free. Let them see clearly that, God, you have a plan and a purpose for them. Lord, let them see clearly that it's time for them to get up, fight again, dream again. Lord God, move on and do things that, God, that, Lord, you would want them to do, to serve again and to be able to honor you with their lives and to be a living testimony of the goodness of God to a world that is in desperate need of this good news. Lord, I just pray for these two young men on this panel. Pray your blessing and anointing upon them as they continue to serve you, not only here, but in many other ways in their communities and in their church. Lord, I pray that you just be with everybody that is hearing this segment today. And I pray your blessings over each and every one of them. Help that struggling parent that is going through some stuff right now with maybe that child that is out there that is going through this mental illness issue. And I pray you strengthen them. Let them put their trust and faith in you. Know that, God, that, Lord, you can do the most miraculous and impossible things. All things are possible in Christ. Lord, we just want to say we love you tonight. We praise you. And we give you all the glory and the honor you alone deserve. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor. We appreciate you being with us this evening. God bless you. And I'm sure we're going to talk to you soon. And let's stay connected.
Yeah.
Aloha. God bless you, Pastor. Have a great evening.
Yeah.
Wow, man. Pastor was going in. Pastor was going in.
Yeah.
Right? Folks on our live, man. Yo, man. Pastor, I mean, what kind of stood out to you, Manny?
You know, a lot of times we're like, we're seeing stuff like, we care. We know. We understand. You know, we're praying for you and stuff like that. I thought that, you know, just like you said earlier, that last part, man, that, hey, get up.
Yeah.
Rise again. You know, like, this is not, you know, after all of this that you've gone through, this is not the end. You know what I mean? It doesn't have to end in suicide. It doesn't have to end, you know, in any attempt of that. But, man, you know, just And then the the unconditional love that you were talking about.
Yeah.
It's crazy, huh? So as ugly as we can be as human beings, yeah. as messed up and as all and as dangerous and you know, to ourselves and to others we can be, God is just like he's just heart emojis with us. You know what I mean? Like he just loves us regardless, man. And yeah. I think that's super amazing, man. You know why? Because if there was a condition to God's love, then some people would be excluded from that, right? Myself.
Surely I wouldn't be here, right?
I wouldn't be here either. I don't think I would be here either. But, you know, to know that, man, he still loves me at my worst.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's something right there, man.
Yeah. But and I thank Pastor Matt for dropping, like, just some deep theology. And I can feel in his spirit that we could go deeper.
Yeah.
Right? But it was just enough to write. You know, from a more of a faith context for us, as, you know, but I think that it's also important to think about the listener who is not a person of faith.
Yeah.
Right. And who is not there. Right. And who may not understand the full breadth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, right. What is our responsibility? And I won't forget those two young people who came on last week, man. Shout out to the Matangi siblings, man. Yeah. And right. These young, one of them is in college, or actually both of them are in college. One is fresh out of high school, but young, just the words, just like, be kind.
Be kind.
Right. That was one of their messaging was just be kind. Like, you know, it doesn't cost anything for us to just be kind, you know, because we never know what anybody's going through. Like Pastor said, like we, you know, and so that's something that I will share. Man, he's like, man, check on your loudest friends.
Yeah.
Check on your loudest homies, because sometimes it's usually
and I'm loud. Super loud. I am though, right, Book?
Yeah.
But I'm okay though.
Are you?
I'm okay.
No, but that's just true, because sometimes, like, when we know, and this is not true for all cases, but in some cases, it's usually your friends that are the most, that are really loud. There's a reason behind them being loud. It's because usually they're covering something up that's happening internally. And so if we don't take the time to, like, if you're close with that person, to, like, check in on folks, we never know what happens. And then all of a sudden you hear or get a text message. Did so-and-so happen? Well, I didn't see that. Right. And so a lot of times it's because we just don't take the time to ask or like say to one another, yo,
I saw. Oh, go ahead.
No, go.
My bad. I'm always doing that. We need like a ticker,
No, you're good, bro.
I saw somebody write that our Samoan people are biased when it comes to mental health. I don't think it's bias. I think it's just a lack of understanding. You know what I mean? And so just like what Pastor John was talking about, like, you know, our older generation is still catching up. They're still trying, you know what I mean, to understand this new world. They live a lot of their life. And this is why I was talking about, Vince, like our generation is so crucial, right? Yeah. Because a lot of our old folks' lives were in that generation where we caught some of that.
Right.
Right? The tail end of that. For you would be like the middle of that.
Wow.
No, I'm just joking. Me and Vince is the tail end of that, right? And so we got the beatings, we got the this, we got the that, we got, you know, all of that stuff. And then also our kids are now growing up in this generation. And so there's a whole new, you know, like he said, there's a shift in culture. There's a shift in the eras. You know what I mean? There's a shift in the generations. And so
this huge unwillingness, right? For kind of the old generation to meet us. Like we're interested, our generation, at least for me, I know I'm interested in how we bridge those two generations.
Yeah,
but,
exactly.
You know, the older generators are not like, they're like, nah, it's our way or the highway.
I don't think it's being biased. I think it's just a lack of understanding. I think we just got to be more open. Everybody, not just us, the old folks, the young folks, because there's some things that I hear from the young folks that are like, man, they don't understand. Bro, you're too fast. You're too slow down.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That's all you got to do is just slow down when you talk to grandpa. He don't understand what you're saying, so he always think you're da-da-da-da-da, you know?
Yeah.
You're talking back to him.
Yeah.
Understand each other. Yeah. And so, you know, I just wanted, that's my thoughts on that. I don't think it's being biased. I think it's just a lack of understanding. And that's what this platform is for. This is what conversation is about. You know what I mean? We talk, and we gain more knowledge and more wisdom about how to move forward from this. Anyway, I just wanted to share this. Real quick, Bug. I thought it was important to share this.
And shout out, this is just a resource. You can screenshot it, take a picture of it. Shout out to M.A. Scarlett Ekaroma, who has her own practice here in Pierce County. And so if you need somebody to talk to, she is available. Or there is a hotline, suicide prevention hotline, where you can, you know, that leads to other resources. I think that it's important for us to share this information. And so, yeah, man, I see a lot of people, everybody's sharing some, dropping some great things. I appreciate that, man. Yeah. It's like super dope. And and when we think about, you know, this whole thing generational, like it is, it's a gap that I feel like needs to be closed, but I think that it takes on us. When you think about the history of the world, all revolutions started with young people.
Yeah.
And so it's going to take us, right? Yeah. Young emerging leaders, you know, who are pastors. I see Jazz on here and Pastor Emo, like young leaders to step up to answer this call.
This is the crazy thing, Boog. Just like what you just said there at the end, answering the call, right? And so if we're the ones who live this generation, a little bit of this, and we're new, we're now walking into this, what happens when we're missing? That middle part is missing. There's no, what happened when I'm not covering that gap right there? What happened is if Vince is missing right there from that gap, then there's never going to be understanding. There's always going to be turmoil. There's always going to be problems because each generation needs to play their role and play their part.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And so it's on us. It really is on us.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Because there's just so much, I mean, for me, a lot of toxic thinking behind, you know, that was embedded in us as young people, right? I'll never forget. I remember you mentioned this. You said this, Manny, which is super important. Like, as a young man, I remember, like, you know, whether it be the elders or parents saying, hey, so like, you know, when you make a mistake, and as a young man, I'm like, wait, what? You about to sass on my head until what comes out?
Until the dope comes out.
Right, and I'm just like, as a young man, when you're hearing that for the first time, it's like, okay, I don't understand what that means, but it sounds pretty bad. But it is that type of thinking when I think, you know what I mean, that narrative that needs just, right, that needs to be changed. It's that toxic thinking, right? And so it takes us as young people to, you know, to step up and answer the call to change that, to have more, create more spaces for us to have these kind of dialogues. So in closing, I want to thank Pastor John and everybody on the live, man. We're just going to pivot for a little bit. Rock with us into our sports segment, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, a lot happened this past weekend in terms of sports. I'm going to turn it over to my also Manny.
Hold on. You want to mention this real quick, Goose?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, man. What is the bidding at right now? So we've pinned this. We want to thank everybody for bidding. But this is an item that we're raffling off. Shout out to our Uso Jacob from the Navajo tribe who donated this. And all the proceeds that we receive from the raffle item will go towards our outreach, suicide prevention outreach back home in American Samoa. Where's the bidding at?
It's at $350. Yep. Wow. Yes, sir. At 350.
I just want to get ready because I know we're transitioning into the sports segment. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to pivot and turn it over to our Uso Manny for our sports segment on Jerusalem. Hi, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, so, the bidding for that, we're up to what is it, 350?
Yeah.
$350. We started off at 25. Shout out to everybody that bid. So by the end of this live, final bid should be in. So if you want to purchase this and support what's happening back home, beat the 350 bid. Meanwhile, I'm just going to chill here with my trophy because we are the world champs, baby.
All right. Here we go.
Hey, look at this, Eddie. Eddie Bay. 17, man.
Let's go. Your sports wrap up with Manny and Bud.
Hey.
Tom Brady and the Buccaneers lose to the Chicago Bears. Field goal, 20-19. Falcons, forever failing Falcons. Look, I don't know what's wrong with this team.
I don't know either, man.
I just don't know.
All I know is somebody about to get fired.
For real. I think he got fired already. He got fired already, yep.
Oh, wow.
And the GM, too. 23-16. This game, though.
Oh, no.
This game, though. The Raiders won the Super Bowl again.
The Raiders won the Super Bowl, ladies and gentlemen.
Josh Jacobs goes over the top for the touchdown. Las Vegas Raiders put 40 on the Chiefs, boy.
Upset. Shout out to the Raiders.
Ooh, look at Josh Jacobs. Tell them to be quiet. Kyler Murray hooks up with Hopkins. Let's go, that boy. That's a grown man, bro. That's a grown man, bro.
That's a big voice cast, man.
That's a grown man right there.
Pastor Mark, you already know.
Cardinals beat the Jets 30-10. Oh, this rookie right here, though. Oh, one. Fuck, I have to show all of it. He's a rookie, bro. That's one. That's one. The Ravens got to watch out for this guy. That's two. How many is that, Bug?
That's two.
Okay. You thought he was done. You thought he was done? He's not done. That's three. It's a rookie, bud.
Yeah, man.
It's a rookie. Let's go. Oh, another one? My boy, Claypool. Four touchdowns on a day for the rookie. Let's go. Steelers beat the Eagles 38-29. The Rams face off with the Washington. Oh, not Redskins. Washington football team. Yep. They don't only need to change their name, they need to change their team and their head coach and their defensive coach and their offensive coach. The Rams win 30-10. But these guys.
Mr. MVP back here.
Ooh, that defense, boy. Let me tell you something. That defense, boy.
You know what we do.
Boy, let me tell you something. That defense, boy.
You
to the house.
We do.
Baltimore Ravens defense cribbing it.
Yes.
Oh, man. Bengals.
Sorry about it, Bengals.
27-3. Baltimore over the Bengals. Sean Watson goes over the middle and hooks up with Brandon Cooks. Texans celebrate their first win of the season.
Shout out to the Texans.
Yes, sir. 30-14. Jags lose again. And then these guys.
Oh, no.
In the Bay Area.
Not Miami.
Was that Tua? Oh, I thought that was Tua, boy. Man. That should have put in Tua.
Nah, don't put it to him, man.
Nah, they shouldn't put it to him to take a knee. It was in the third quarter. 43-17. And then this guy, everybody know Phillips, bro. What are you about to do, Bug? This is supposed to be the number one defense. They can't even play because Rivers over here throwing pick six. Backwards touchdowns.
Backward touchdown, man. Come on.
32-23. Let's go.
Get him out of there.
Ooh, prayers to Dak Prescott. Yeah, we all see what happened
to Dak, man.
Prayers to Dak, man. That was tough.
Boys put off the window.
Yep, we don't ever want to see anybody get injured like that, man.
Nope.
So prayers to Dak. Cowboys win over the Giants 37-34. And then this game, boy.
Oh, man, this is a dope game.
Fourth and goal. Russ hooks up with
win the game.
DK Metcalf. Bruh.
First name Russell, last name Wilson.
For real, that man is filthy. Vikings lose 26-27. Tough loss. Monday Night Football. He's taking it in. He faked the pass. See that? That was nice.
Yeah, man.
That was nice. I feel so sorry for Herbert, though.
Yeah, man. He's nice too,
I feel
man.
Sorry for Herbert, bro. Herbert is so nice.
Well, they're just a couple pieces away from.
But Badgley, they've got the pieces already. It's that kicker that keep missing the game-winning field goals.
That's true,
man. Saints win 30-27. And then tonight. COVID pushed the game back to Tuesday. Ryan Tannehill, he's doing it, man. This boy is doing it. I don't know what kind of move that was. I don't know what kind of move that was, but they did that. They spanked him. It was ugly. 42-6.
Bills Mafia, not tonight.
I know want to take a break right here. And usually we go into a slap yourself a segment, yes. You know, the slap yourself segment. But tonight, something happened. What day was it,
tell
bud?
Tell him what day happened. Tell him what happened on Sunday, on the Lord's Day.
On Sunday. All right, and we're just going to continue on with the video. The video will speak for itself, but we got to go ahead. I want to be the first, Boog. Can I be the first?
Be the first, Zeus.
To congratulate my brother, Boog, and his Los Angeles Lakers.
Thank you.
Winning the NBA World Championship, man.
Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Hey. Oh, man. Thank you, man. This is really... Hey! Let's go! This is the king! It's the king, baby! Hey, man!
I wish this was us.
Hey! Let's go, baby! Come on!
Yeah. Sing it, Bug! Sing it, Bug!
Come on! Come on! Hey. Hey. Come on. Let's go. Let's show. I am enjoying every second of this. Look at that. It's going up in LA, man, at the Staples Center, baby. I can't wait to be there, man, for the parade. Yes. Yes. J.R. Smith, you got a free ring, man. It's cool. We'll give it to you, J.R. That's for the Mamba, baby. Mamba. Yes, that's friend. Hey, rest in peace, Mamba.
Did you enjoy that? Did you enjoy that, Boog? Sing this last part.
I thoroughly enjoyed that.
Sing this last part, Oos.
We love you, Mamba. That's for Mamba. Hey, man. Shout out to Marso Manny for putting
yes,
that
sir,
piece
yes,
together.
Yes, sir.
He knows. Much respect, man. And shout out to my Lakers. Shout out to everybody. Even shout out to Miami, man. Jimmy Buckets and the whole Miami squad.
Yeah, man.
Man, I appreciate you guys,
if,
man.
If you're a betting man, right? If you're a betting person and you bet it and you put your money on Miami to make it to the finals, you would be sitting pretty right now. Nobody saw Miami sitting here in the finals. And they did it, so props to them. But the Lakers are the champions.
Yes, that's right.
What number is that?
That's number 17, baby.
17 with the asterisk next to it, right?
No.
Because the COVID year, the bubble.
This is like LeBron said, the hardest one to get was in the bubble. And so shout out to the Lake Show, man, for bringing it back home.
Yes, sir.
For Mamba. This one's for Mamba and his daughter. Man, it feels so great to hoist this up, Manny.
Yes,
and I want to thank Coach Vogel for sending me my personalized NBA championship trophy right here, man. Thank you so much, man. And shout out to the Lake Show, the real Lake Show family, man. All you new folks that just jumped on the bandwagon, it's all good.
Yeah.
Come on. We'll take y'all on the ride.
That's what I'm saying, man.
We'll take y'all on the ride.
That's what I'm saying, man. For those of you new guys who try to attack me, I don't care if Boog attacked me and those diehards, man, but you new guys who try to attack me, know your role before you come against a real one. I'll tell you straight, bro.
Nah, my also, man, I mean, and this is a good one, too. Like, the day that, we got the news Kobe passed, man, I was in church, and I was actually doing some church stuff. Like, I was getting all these text messages, like, from everybody, my family, friends that know, how much I love the Lakers. you know, and I shared this in previous podcasts, like how much I, you know, follow Kobe, and I've actually gotten to some fights over, with family members, some of my brothers arguing over Kobe is the GOAT. And so, but I didn't know how impacted I was until that day. And I remember Mauso Manny reaching out, and we actually, we watched that game, that first game back at Staples together. And Manny said, man, and we're always going back talking smack. And Manny was like, man, I'm, you know, this year I hope the Lakers win it for Mamba. And I'm not going to post or say anything just in respect for Mamba. And he kept to his word. He didn't, man. As much as he wanted to. And if you're a Celtics fan.
I never smack talked the Lakers. I only cheered for my team. Usually I'll be smack talking the Lakers.
All the time. All the time. But he did. And he kept his word, man. That was just respect for Mamba, really, man, and all he did for the game. So this one, a special one, man. So shout out to the Lake Show for bringing him back to L.A.
Mamba's the man.
Yes, sir. Shout out to everybody that's on the live, man. We appreciate you guys rocking with us tonight, man. Well, thank you. What is our final bid at?
We're at 360. Somebody texted in 390, and then they said, oh, sorry. Then they, I don't know. They said something, but we're at 360 right now.
So we're at 360. We'll give you guys about 1 minute to anybody. Yeah. Like I said, we want to show that bracelet real quick, just a picture. Yeah. You don't have to play the video. We'll show this last viewing of this picture. This was donated by our Uso Jacob from the Navajo tribe. And he asked us to raffle it off, and whatever dollars we receive from it that we could would go towards our suicide prevention outreach efforts back home in American Samoa. If you're just joining us, we are sending a pallet this Friday of items that we were collected for outreach back home. And we want to thank everybody back home in Samoa and also here at SeaTac who are helping us to get these pallets back home. And so all these dollars, this item is valued at $1,200. And shout out to our Navajo brother Jacob for donating.
Yeah, man,
beautiful
love.
Piece. And it's love. Thank you to everybody that, you know, donated and put in a bid. We appreciate your dollars and pray that God just bless you all tenfold. So final bid is at 360, right, Manny?
360.
Going once. Going twice.
Text.
Text coming through. Text coming through.
Let's get 30 more seconds. 30 more seconds.
30 more seconds. 30 more seconds. We'll give you 30 more seconds. Sure. 30 more seconds. If you want to make a final bid, we're at 360. You can help us get this pallet. You can help us continue to provide our outreach efforts back home in Samoa. Every penny and donation will go towards helping to pay for more items or helping our outreach team back home in American Samoa get the resources that they need to be able to provide this much needed outreach on a conversation that we spent a lot of time tonight talking about. Shout out to Pastor John and Good Samaritan Worship Center out in San Diego. Thank you guys. Time up.
Time is up.
Going once, going twice.
Sold.
Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you to the person that purchased it for $360. Yep. God bless you all. And we will see you guys on Friday for Fire Fridays, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, sir.
We'll post who will be on our show. Just be on the lookout. Also, this Thursday, tap in this Thursday for the DJ Una show.
Yes, sir.
That's Thursday at 8 p.m., actually about 7:45. Tap in with the DJ Una show. He will have local artists on. He'll also be spinning live music on the DJ Una show. So tap in for some good vibes this Thursday with DJ Una, man, and the DJ Una show, man. It's been a blessing to rock with y'all tonight. We will see you guys on Thursday with DJ Una, and then we're back here again on Friday with Fire Fridays. God bless you all.
Yes, sir.
Lake Show for life. Mamba forever.
Tell her, enough already.
Mamba forever. We love y'all. God bless y'all. Stay safe.
You own it, Uso.
All right, Uso. Love you, bro.
Love you too, bro.
Yes, sir.